Have you ever put your professional life together better than it ever had been put together before, only to be furloughed for nearly a year, forcing you to hang out in a city where half the people speak French and don't care about your industry because they much prefer this other industry? And then, when you're finally allowed to work again, your company is a shell of its former self, erasing all of that progress that you made to the point that your parent company just ups and moves you out of the country and into a swamp. No? Just the 1994 Expos then? To the Dubs. Everything we do here is an excuse to tell a lot of baseball stories and a lot of jokes, so if that sounds interesting to you, stay in the know and help us grow with a shiny free of charge subscription to the channel. Today we're taking a look at the third team in Group B of our experimental baseball tournaments in the 1994 Montreal Expo. Should the teams meet in the playoffs, these guys in the 1981 Reds over in Group A can fight over who was screwed over more by a Major League Baseball strike. The Expos might actually have a leg up here. The life of an expansion team is rough. You're expected to be pretty bad for a while. The talent you get out of an expansion draft isn't the best, so the growth process is a bit of an uphill battle. Or I guess you could be the Marlins and win two titles in your first 11 years despite no one in your home state even realizing you play there. But as tough as things are supposed to be, the Expos sure milked their ineptitude until its snout came out of its udders. 1969 was their first season. Their first season over 500 was 1979. It was actually a pretty great season. They won 95 games, but playoff qualification was a bit more stringent back in the 70s, and it was the 98 win Pittsburgh Pirates that went on to the playoffs that year. Their first appearance in the playoffs was in that weird 1981 season we went over in the Reds video. The Reds didn't make the playoffs despite having the best record across the entire span of that season, but the Expos did make it. A record of 30-23 was good enough to beat tops in the East in the second half of the season, which in turn was good enough to put them in the postseason, ahead of the Cardinals, who were technically two games ahead of them across the two halves of the season. They were victorious in their first playoff series against the Phillies, but fell to the Dodgers in the NLCS. The decisive fifth game entered the ninth, tied at one, but Rick Munday's home run for the Dodgers in the top of that inning would be the decisive blow in what would become called Blue Monday. The Expos had some decent seasons after 1981, but rolled into the 1994 season without any other playoff appearances. It was looking like the 94 season would be different. After their first 114 games, the Expos sat at a winning percentage of .649. This was far and away the best season the franchise had ever seen. In fact, let's plot all of their winning percentages and see how long it takes you to find 1994. Yep, that one. The reason I cited the weird number of 114 games is that was it. The season was canceled after that. It was the first time in North American professional sports that the entire postseason was canceled. The players were on strike. They didn't want a salary cap. They didn't want to share broadcasting revenue. And so, David Fair, who headed up the Players Association at the time, gave a big fat no to these proposals and threatened a September strike. There was bickering. I'm sure things were said that would later be regretted, but the owners took things to the next level and withheld nearly $8 million they had previously agreed to pay into players' pensions and benefit plans. Shortly thereafter, the players took another loss when the antitrust legislation failed to make it past the Senate Judiciary Committee, which, if won, would have had all sorts of positive implications on things like a team's long-term control over a player. So they set a date to strike, August 12th, 1994, and sure enough, August 11th was the last day the players showed up for work. The story of Cliff Floyd, who was the rookie starting first baseman for the Expos that year, really paints a picture of how this impacted the young Expos players. He stayed in Montreal as long as he could after the strike, not giving up hope that the season would restart and that the club would have a shot at the World Series. I mean, this is what the union rep was telling the team to do: stay close and keep working out. There's no way this thing lasts past September, and even if it does, the MLB would make some sort of altered postseason plan which would naturally include the Expos. They would never cancel a World Series. That's as American as shooting a brick of Velveeta cheese with a gun. I'm sure a championship would have meant a lot intrinsically to Floyd, but when you're new to the league, the monetary benefits of a championship would also mean quite a bit. Rookies don't make Max Scherzer money, who this year, if you're hoping for 30 starts out of him, which is admittedly aggressive because Max is likely to injure himself chewing through a power line or something of the sort, would be making $1.4 million every time he took the mound. Instead, it became too expensive to stay in Montreal, so he moved back home to Chicago and started working at Service Merchandise for the holiday season. A rookie ball player that had made the big league club, netted a starting spot, and was hitting 281, and seemingly headed for postseason success, went to working retail like the rest of us schleps. This is an Expos video, but I'll at least quickly highlight some of the other parties that were screwed by the cancellation of the season. In the earlier video for Diamonds in the Rough, we mentioned that Tony Gwynn had a real shot at hitting 400. Matt Williams was on pace to beat Roger Maris' single season mark of 61 home runs, something the MLB secretly had to turn Sosa and Maguire into super soldiers for years later in order to entice fans back to the ballpark after this strike slapped the face of the fans. The Rockies were on pace to beat attendance records for the second year running in Mile High Stadium's final year. When baseball resumed, they would call Coors Field home, and despite having a seating capacity of over 50,000, average daily capacity never really recovered. Coors beer tastes like licking an aluminum playground slide after a long day of dirty children running all over it in 90-degree weather. That doesn't really tie into anything in the narrative, but I felt like it needed to be said. The Yankees hadn't been to the playoffs since 1981, which was that weird year with the Reds in the split seasons. They had the largest divisional lead at the time, and fan favorite Donnie Baseball looked to have his first postseason appearance clinched before the curtains were closed. If you need any additional evidence than the past 3 years, how stubborn the sides can be during these debacles, you need look no further than the incident where the current president of the United States and Bill Clinton demanded the sides resume negotiations in February. They responded, nah. So 95 rolls around, and Bud Selig uses the always classy strike-busting move of letting in scab players, but this idea was not as wildly successful as the XFL's two shots of getting off the ground. Scabs were offered $5,000 if they made it to spring training, and another $5,000 if they made the roster. Bud didn't really think this one through. For one, the Blue Jays weren't allowed to field replacement players based on an extension of a no-scab labor law. Their solution? They planned to play their home games at the nearby town of Dunedin, Florida. This whole video is one prolonged dump on Canada, I guess. Also, Sparky Anderson, manager of the Detroit Tigers, refused to manage replacement players, which I'm sure brought up daddy issues for more than a few of the scabs. Regardless, the 1995 season was all set to begin with replacement players, but at the 11th hour, Sonia Sotomayor, yes, that Sotomayor of the Supreme Court, though she was just a lowly judge at this point, threw the players a bone. The players said they'd come back if the U.S. District Court supported their complaint of unfair labor practices. Sonia did just that, binding players and owners to the terms of the former collective bargaining agreement until they could bring themselves to agree to a new one. So, baseball was back, but the fans were pissed. Attendance was way down. Montreal was forced to lower payroll and trade away some of their higher-salaried players, so the squad that had delivered the best season in their club's history was gutted. Larry Walker left in free agency to the Rockies. Over the course of 2 days in April of 95, they traded away three All-Stars. And that was the beginning of the end for the Expos, as the league took control of the club in 2002 and moved them out to DC not long after. A young Expo in Pedro Martinez thinks that if they could have kept the club together, they would have won two or three titles. Though Pedro has also said that throwing Don Zimmer was super duper fun and everyone should try it. So let's take a look at the club and start imagining how they'll stack up against other teams in Group B. We'll start with the players we've named already. The story of Cliff Floyd didn't end in the hellish landscape of customer service in the end. He remained with the Expos until 1997 and said his time there helped him grow personally and professionally, which is the sports equivalent of trying to sell your friend on a double date by saying his or her date has a great personality. He moved on to the Marlins, which you might imagine being even worse, but he immediately won a World Series. He eventually made it back to the Expos and stayed there for a grand total of 2 weeks this time before being traded to the Red Sox. This may have been a little shady, as by this point, the Expos were owned by the MLB, and some thought that maybe the MLB was attempting to line their own pockets by willing the Red Sox, a franchise more likely to produce a rabid television audience in the postseason, to the World Series, which is something they hadn't won since 1915 at that point. He's a versatile outfielder that excelled at all three positions and finished his career with over 200 home runs hit. Larry Walker was a beast, and it was a heartbreaking loss when he left the Expos upon the resumption of baseball in 1995. His career accolades include being the only player in history of baseball to register a 700 slugging percentage while also stealing 30 bases. He won the Golden Glove 7 different times, netted 3 silver sluggers, and had a batting average of 360 or higher in 3 consecutive seasons. Unfortunately, this all happened post-Expos and may have been aided by the air in Colorado, which in that era was playing thinner than Calista Flockhart on a fast. He's one of the two Hall of Famers on the squad, having been inducted in 2020. Pedro Martinez is the other Hall of Famer. Pedro spent his age 22 to 25 seasons with the Expos and had just hit his stride when he moved on from Montreal after the 97 season. That 97 season saw him cracking a 2 ERA for the first time in his career, an AL best 1.90 with 300 strikeouts in 13 complete games. The wacky thing was that was only his second best year. He was a three-time Cy Young winner, a unanimous choice twice for the award, led the league in ERA on 5 different occasions, and WHIP in 6, and has netted over 3,000 strikeouts, good for 15th all-time. Marquise Grissom joins Larry Walker in the outfield, and if nothing else, Expos fans can at least say they saw one player at their peak, as he went for over 70 stolen bases on 2 occasions with the club. He won 4 gold gloves and netted a postseason MVP award in 1997 when he helped the Cleveland Indians to the World Series, where they promptly lost to the, holy crap, it's the Marlins again. Who had that bet? A video about the 94 Montreal Expos, and we fit in both Marlins championships into the script. Some 80-year-old in Florida named Ruth is thanking me right now, and literally no one else cares. No worries about the 97 World Series loss, however, as he did get a ring in 95 with the Atlanta Braves, the year baseball returned from the strike that killed the Expos. Rounding out the outfield, it's Felipe Alou's son and Moises Alou. Felipe actually had a short stint with the Expos himself. Here he is, scoring the walk-off run against the Cardinals in 1973. Moises must not have listened to his father's advice, as he played 6 seasons with the club before leaving for the World Series champ, you guessed it, Marlins, in 1997. Now, I'm not going to talk about this moment. We're not going to talk about that moment, but we can talk about Alou's fiery temper, as he was convinced umpires were out to get him. Out to get him or not, he still managed 6 All-Star bids and a career batting average north of 300. Moving into the infield, we've got Mark Lansing at second base. We talked a little bit about how embarrassing it must have been for the Black Sox players who played horribly during the World Series, but were eventually proven innocent in the vein of, you sucked, but you suck because you suck. The same might be said for Mark Lansing, who was named in the Mitchell Report as a player who had some pretty hard evidence that he was using performance enhancers to explain away. His performance, even though enhanced, was pretty average. He had fewer than 100 career home runs and hit for a decent average of 271 over his career. A solid contributor, but that human growth hormone didn't add much human to him. At short, we've got Will Cordero. The 1994 strike took what looked to be this guy's best season away from him. He was an All-Star and received a Silver Slugger, the only time he received both honors. In full seasons when he was starting most games, he would never top his .294 batting average, his .363 on-base percentage, and his .489 slugging. His departure from the Expos after the 95 season turned him into a bit of a journeyman, though he did return to Montreal in 2002 and 2003, putting up some nice numbers in the twilight of his career. Sean Barry is starting at third base. This is another solid contributor who doesn't really stand out on a crowd. He was one of the lesser-known bees of the Astros' killer bees. He wasn't bad, but he wasn't Biggio, Berkman, or Bagwell. I can just picture him in the corner of a post-game press conference gesturing wildly at the first letter of his last name on the back of his jersey, hoping he could get in on that marketing. Darren Fletcher should be getting most of the starts behind the plate. This guy reads a bit like Will Cordero's career. His one and only All-Star appearance came in the season the strike killed. His numbers weren't all that special. He led the league in sac flies, which is neat. He was credited with being excellent behind the plate and was given his share of the credit for the excellent performance of the starting rotation in 94 as they led the league in ERA. Coming off the bench, we've got two backup catchers in Tim Spare and Lenny Webster. Lenny would be in the league 12 seasons, as many teams appeared pleased to give him the role of backing up a better catcher. Tim Spare had much the same story. Freddy Benavides was an infielder who never returned to baseball after 94, though to be fair, he didn't show up much in baseball prior to that either. Jeff Gardner should get some time in the infield, and Lou Frazier will back up the outfield. Lou's found some baseball employment after his playing career, coaching the Pirates outfield and serving as the first base coach in 2007 and 2008 when he was fired. This came during the unfortunate stretch where the Pirates finished in last place for 4 straight years, but really, how much damage can be done at first base? We already touched on Pedro Martinez, so let's find out who else the Expos have in the pitching rotation. Ken Hill finished second in Cy Young voting, losing out to Greg Maddux, who was having arguably his best season. He put up 8.5 WAR in a season that was killed prematurely, so he did that only while making 25 starts, netting his career-low ERA of 1.56. The tragedy of the strike is that Ken Hill was never the same pitcher. 1994 represented his 4th straight year with a sub-4 ERA. When baseball came back in 95, he was shipped out of Montreal to St. Louis in Operation We Have No Money Anymore. He didn't last a full season with his new club, as he was once again shipped out in a mid-season trade to the Indians, and the sub-4 ERA seasons were very few and far between after that. Over the next several several years, he would be released by the Angels, White Sox, Devil Rays, which, wow, and the Reds. Next up, we've got Gabe Hill. He put up a 6.01 ERA in 94 for the Spos and somehow did worse in 95. He should be thanking us for making him relevant to baseball again. His Wikipedia entry is brief, and the one thing that it talks about is someone else's accomplishment. Jeff Fassero is the next member of the rotation. Fassero had a nice long career despite not showing up in the majors until the age of 28. He'd be 43 before he called it quits, however, which is a major achievement when your numbers pretty much sucked from the age 36 onward. None of that was with the Expos, though. Maybe there was something about that Canadian air, as Jeff sported a sub-3 ERA for his first 4 years in the league, all with the Expos. And bringing up the rear in the rotation, we have Butch Henry. His one shining year was 1994, so I imagine he just loves to talk about the strike. Notables in the bullpen include Mel Rojas, who picked up 16 saves for the Expos in 94, John Wetland, who was the primary closer and would go on to lead the league in saves in 96, for the Yankees, Kirk Reuter, who finished in the top 10 for Rookie of the Year in 1993, and Jeff Shaw, who was a two-time All-Star, though those bids would come further down the road than his time in Montreal. That's the book on the 94 Expos, and we are rapidly approaching the final team reveal before seeing how the tournament shakes out. Come back tomorrow for that final team. Once again, if you've enjoyed this video, please consider subscribing, hitting that thumbs up, or leaving some comments to let us know what you think, as we love to hear feedback. And as always, I've been Johnny Paprika, hoping all of your balls are fair and all of your wood is good. Good night, everybody.